Good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting in 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business today is a decision to take in private the evidence received this morning and also to It's also to agree to take in private an approach to the paper on the Bankruptcy and Diligence Scotland Bill and our draft annual report. That would be in private at next week's meeting. If I can get an agreement for that, that would be helpful. Thank you. Right, so our first item of business this morning is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy on the Scottish Government's policy priorities. So I welcome Neil Gray, Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy, who is joined by Colin Cook, who is Director of Economic Development, Gary Gillespie, Chief Economist, and Nick Young, Head of Carbon Capture, Utilisation and Storage and Industrial Decarbonisation. As always, if members and witnesses can keep their questions and answers as concise as possible, that would be helpful. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener, and thank you to the Committee for giving me the opportunity to be here today and share the Government's priorities in my portfolio area. The impacts of the cost crisis, the pandemic, Brexit and fiscal instability brought on by the UK Government decisions have brought untold damage to our economy, with persistent high inflation and unprecedented drops in living standards. Coupled with the climate and nature emergency, these crises have exposed fundamental weaknesses in the current economic system. This backdrop underlines the need to transform our economy to one that is resilient and prioritises well-being, one that serves people, not the other way round. As the transition to a well-being economy, we will embed equality, inclusion and human rights into everything that we do. And I'm committed to the First Minister's three interlinked missions of growing a fairer, greener economy, seizing the opportunities of net zero and creating better communities. At the heart of a well-being economy is economic growth for a purpose: to drive improved living standards, promote well-being, reduce poverty and deliver sustainable, high-quality public services. Harnessing and combining the economic power and opportunity of Scotland's rich renewable energy resources, the skills and talents of our people and businesses will be critical to achieving this. We will work closely with the private sector, the public sector, locally, nationally and UK-wide, and we will engage directly with communities and partners in the third sector. Working with my Cabinet colleagues, we will deliver our national strategy for economic transformation with a sharp focus on policies and actions with the greatest potential to grow and change Scotland's economy, expand the tax base to fund excellent public services and make people's lives better. This will require a new approach to the Government's relationship with business. At the request of the First Minister, I will engage widely with business leaders to develop and agree a new deal with the private sector for how we will work with business to deliver a growing economy that increases well-being. I laid out my priorities in the First Minister's prospectus for what I want to deliver over the next 3 years, and no doubt you'll want to hold me account on these. My priorities include more people in work, more people earning at least the real living wage and narrowing the gender pay gap, more business creation and growing to scale, increased investment in productive assets, internationally competitive clusters of excellence, including in green technologies, health and life sciences, digital and advanced manufacturing, greater regional and local economic empowerment, including through our programme of community wealth building, and further growth in exports and more high-quality inward investment. A just transition for our energy sector is arguably the biggest opportunity that we have. There is a huge opportunity to establish Scotland as an exporter of green hydrogen to Europe, and analysis shows that overall the number of low-carbon jobs in energy production could rise to 77,000 by 2050. The potential can be seen in the ScotWind offshore leasing round, which has delivered more than £750 million in revenues already and will bring billions of pounds in investment to into Scottish supply chain and the wider economy. And the recent announcement that Japanese company Sumitomo Electric is coming to Scotland to build a cable manufacturing plant demonstrates the strength of confidence investors have in our net zero economy vision. So I look forward to discussing some of these points with you in greater detail this morning. I appreciate your opportunity you've given me for setting out my stall this morning.
Thank you very much. You have covered a wide range of issues, and the committee will be also covering a breadth of issues this morning, but we look forward to a constructive relationship as we look at our inquiries and future work programmes. Can I just maybe start with an opening question around the change in emphasis to your job title, which was an economy, it's now been changed to wellbeing economy. It's just over a year since the publication of the 10-year economic strategy. Is there an intention to look again at the strategy, to look at where the priority areas are, look at the 5 programmes of action? What will reflect the change in emphasis to the economy role?
So the wellbeing economy elements run through NSET already. We've got a wellbeing economy metric built in through NSET that means that we're continually monitoring the progress that we have on those areas that we want to chart, including our sustainability, targets on child poverty, ensuring that we are narrowing the gender pay gap, for instance, and ensuring that we've got more people going into employment. The change in job title is around providing a refocus, about making sure that there is a prominence given to wellbeing elements. But the First Minister has also set me a very clear task, which is to reset the relationship with business and to ensure that that relationship is strong, that business continues to perform well, to ensure that we're able to deliver the wellbeing elements of what we're wanting to achieve in government. No, there isn't going to be a change to NSET. There'll be a sharpening of our focus, which comes from the policy prospectus, which looks at the areas that I've set out that come directly from NSET. But we are committed to continuing to deliver on the priorities that are within the National Strategy for Economic Transformation.
There is some criticism that there's an oversimplification or there's ambition over delivery when it comes to looking at how a wellbeing economy could actually be introduced, that the tensions that are there between, for example, maybe our international trade policies and our cooperative policies, or one example has been used, the deposit return scheme, the way in which that was trying to balance different interests. It's fine to declare we have a wellbeing economy, but it's how do we deal with the tensions that arise from that? And how does the government really intend to get to the nub of that?
So NSET is the guiding light there, because that has the metrics, the measures within it to ensure that we are tracking the progress that we have. I don't think that there are tensions there. I think there are areas where we need to make sure that we are delivering well for people and for our planet, and that the deposit return scheme is one area of that. But it's also, the deposit return scheme is also an economic opportunity. If we can get recycling rates right, that is a clear business opportunity for dealing with commodities that are coming through the waste market. So I think there are major opportunities coming forward. What the wellbeing economy elements do is make sure that we're focused on delivering for people, not just the traditional GDP growth elements. Growth is important, but it's important for a purpose, and that is to ensure that we're delivering for better lives for people across Scotland.
When Kate Forbes published the document just over a year ago, the focus was on entrepreneurship and encouraging growth within the economy. Is that still the focus of the plan?
Yes, that work is still ongoing. You can see the work that's been done with the TechScaler network. We are currently analysing Anna Stewart's report and Mark Logan's report on women entrepreneurs, and we are looking at what more we'll be able to do to make Scotland an entrepreneurial hub.
And when we had the Deputy First Minister was here the last time on this topic, he said the first annual progress report covering NSET would be published in 2022. I don't think that's been published yet. Do we have has it been published? Do we have a timescale for that? Or
I'll bring Gary in here.
Sorry, it's not published yet. It'll be due in May, I think, towards the end of May.
OK, that might give the committee an opportunity to scrutinise that and come back to these issues. Ms Hislop, did you have a supplementary to the statement?
Two areas. One, on your opening remarks, Where do you think there are specific vulnerabilities to the Scottish economy, and what measures, therefore, are you taking to support Scotland's economy?
There's been clear damage done to Scotland's economy by decisions that have been taken out with our control. Brexit has had a major impact on Scotland's economy, a greater impact than the COVID pandemic. And the UK mini-budget, delivered by Kwasi Kwarteng and Liz Truss, has also had a devastating impact. So the key risks to Scotland's economy come from areas out with our control. We are doing what we can to mitigate those by providing increased business support and looking to areas where we can maximise growth and job opportunities, such as the entrepreneurial network, the tech scaler network that the convener raised earlier on.
And then you also mentioned in your opening remarks about the importance of building a resilient economy. You may be familiar with this committee's report into the supply chain for Scotland to build a resilient supply chain to withstand some of the risks, but also to maybe address issues like embedded carbon, carbon miles, the smart use of procurement, perhaps advanced manufacturing, looking at Scottish-based domestic supply chains which are shorter, which also are greener, but also are more resilient. Is that an area that you would look at, and would you draw on the committee's report in that regard?
Yes, absolutely. We spoke about some of this yesterday, Ms Hislop and I, regarding ensuring that we have a strong domestic supply chain to feed our offshore wind opportunities, and we're continuing to do what we can to ensure that is brought forward. But I'll bring in the Chief Economist here to supplement that, to give more detail.
Yeah, so just the supply chain element obviously started during COVID. We were looking at how we could boost local supply given the supply chain issues with COVID, in particular issues of health. I think what we're seeing is a reset in economy at the moment, and actually the resilience point is really about not just within Scotland, UK, businesses are looking at shorter supply lines now and looking to take out carbon elements, looking to make the supply chains much more secure so that they're not impacted by external events in other countries. So we're seeing that continuation in Scotland. I think the best example is probably around the ScotWind programme, where along with the offshore licences, there's a commitment to really build the supply chain. And I think that's what you need to do. But it's not just in that sector. I think what we've seen since EU exit is a reorientation of trade, less imports, more local supply coming to the fore, because it's more difficult to trade both inward and outward. So I think that rebalancing is happening in the economy. And it's both a challenge and an opportunity. There's an opportunity for businesses in Scotland to kind of really embed that opportunity to supply much more locally in a much more sustainable fashion.
I mean, I think we'd be interested in knowing what you're doing to help support that shorter supply chain, not just obviously in the Scotland area, but in the wider economy as well. Can we know?
Sorry, I was just to come back on Ms Hislop's previous question about the risks that there are to Scotland's economy. I should have mentioned the fact that Scotland's economy is performing incredibly resiliently, considering the difficulties that there have been following Brexit, COVID and the UK mini-budget. The economic growth currently outstrips that of the rest of the UK. Last year we had much stronger economic growth than the rest of the UK. We will continue to do what we can to support our economy in the face of the very difficult challenges that businesses, the third and private sectors are facing.
OK, thank you. I'll bring in Graeme Simpson to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you've got a massive brief. You cover an awful lot. So I'm just going to focus on probably just one bit of it, and that's something that the Auditor General referred to in a report, and that's Scottish Government investment into private companies. He made some sort of quite tough comments, and he said of your involvement in BIFAB, Ferguson Marine, Prestwick Airport, Millock Harbour Smelter, that the financial support for these four companies has not delivered expected outcomes and is unlikely to achieve value for money. So I want to ask you today about Prestwick, and then I'll ask you about Ferguson's. So the Auditor General said of Prestwick, the airport was bought by the government in November 2013. It's had loan support of £43.4 million. That was up to the 31st of March last year. And when he wrote that report, it was valued at, that loan support was valued at 11.6 million. Do you know what the value is now?
I'll bring in Colin Cook at this point. I don't know the current value off the top of my head, no.
Perhaps Mr. Cook knows.
No, I'm afraid I'd have to come back to the committee with a precise valuation. And I think it's worth saying that we continually work with the board of Prestwick Airport, and we do receive offers to purchase the asset, because it is recognised to be a strong asset both nationally and particularly for the economy of Ayrshire. So that question is something that we would keep under review. But I will come back to the committee if we have a more updated valuation.
Thank you. Is there any current interest in buying the airport?
I haven't had any signal to me, but we continue to discuss opportunities like that with the management of Prestwick Airport. In my mind, it's, as Mr. Cook has outlined, the business is profitable. The most recent information we have is that it's the operating profit was 1.9 million, profit before tax was 1.2 million. It's a good going concern, so I'd expect commercial interest to be forthcoming, and where that interest arrives at government, we would have of course looked to support Prestwick returning to the private sector as soon as is practical.
And is it still your intention to sell the airport?
Yes,
it is. You said that you're not aware of any interest in buying.
Nothing
the airport.
Has come.
Any
has
of
come
your officials.
Me.
And there have been, and there are regularly approaches of various qualities and standards. Around Prestwick Airport, there's nothing at the moment on the table that we would regard as a going offer, let us say.
I see. That's interesting, because I'm aware that there is currently there has been an expression of interest which has been put to the board of the airport in buying the airport, and I am concerned that you, Cabinet Secretary, are not aware of that, and it would seem to me that you should be aware of that. I'm not blaming you for that. There seems to be a problem here. You have not been given that information.
The process that is followed is that if we do receive an offer, then the board of Prestwick Airport consider that offer. If they believe that there is something in that offer, or it is in the sort of ballpark that we should be interested in, they then talk to us and we would go forward and we'd involve the Cabinet Secretary at that point. At the moment, as I say, there is no offer on the table that the Board of Prestwick Airport consider to be a realistic and sustainable proposition. That may well change because, as I said, constantly there are people interested in what is a fantastic asset for Ayrshire and Scotland.
It is a fantastic asset. So it seems to me what you're describing here is if the board of the airport decides this offer or expression of interest is not worth telling government about, that's where it ends.
No, the board of the airport would always talk to us about any offer that we receive. We would receive that offer and we would consider it. We would take the views of the board as the initial starting point of our analysis. If there's something in that offer, if we think it is worth pursuing, we would then do what we would always do in these situations, which is to draw in external advice, specialist advice, and make sure that we get a good deal for the Scottish taxpayer. As I said, at the moment, that latter process is not being carried out on any particular offer. But if we do get an offer that looks on the face of it to be worthwhile, we would do that.
Okay. So I've informed you that I'm aware of an expression of interest. I would expect you to go away and have a look at that. Can I ask you about this loan? Because there was a big loan, and you know, can I ask you, is the government at any point going to be asking for that money back?
So obviously we keep the situation under constant review, and we'll be looking to recoup the money that's been invested in Prestwick as best as we possibly can to ensure that there is good value for the public purse. That is what Mr. Simpson, I'm sure, would expect.
OK. I'll move on to Ferguson Marine, if that's OK.
Mr. Simpson, I'm prepared to allow time for questioning today, but I hope you're not intending to go through every been willing to buy fab after Ferguson Marine, or I don't have enough time to do all the areas you might be interested in.
No. I just said Prestwick and Ferguson Marine.
Okay, that's fine.
And
thank you.
Very quickly, because you know it's been
That's no problem.
We know the issues around Ferguson Marine. Mm-hmm. We don't need to rehearse them. I just have simply, I mean, again, I refer to questions from the Auditor General raised in his recent report. He doesn't know what the future holds. What do you think the future holds for Ferguson Marine? I mean, what are the prospects for this yard, in your view?
Well, I hope that we can continue, that Ferguson Marine can continue to make progress to being a commercially successful yard. That was the intention of saving the last commercial yard on the Clyde, to ensure that we protect the jobs, that we can protect the manufacturing base that is there and the traditions of Scottish manufacturing. Clearly there have been challenges at Ferguson's, that is well documented, but we continue to work with the management and the workforce to ensure that the two vessels are delivered as quickly as possible, and then there is the opportunity for Ferguson's to bid for further work and to make itself commercially successful.
And at some point, same question about Prestwick, really. Is it your intention to return Ferguson Marine to the private sector?
Yes.
Okay. How do you think you're going to get to that point?
Well, obviously, we would. The better Ferguson's is performing, the more likely it is that it's going to return to private ownership. We'll continue to, if there are interested parties, come forward, or are we'll talk to government, or indeed to our agencies. Then clearly, we will take that interest seriously and do what we can to ensure that it's the yard is returned as a commercial going concern into private ownership as quickly as possible.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Colin Beattie, to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, there's a couple of areas I would like to just explore. Could you perhaps give us an update on the review of the skills landscape being led by James Withers and the plans to refresh the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan? And also, on the back of that, how will these two reviews be joined up?
Thank Mr. Beattie for that question. We're expecting Mr. Withers' report very soon. When that arrives, both myself and colleagues across government, because obviously this has this touches on areas of responsibility not just for myself, but Jenny Gilruth and Graeme Day and others across government, we will ensure we respond to that in a timeous fashion and take what he has, what he says seriously. In terms of the second element, in terms of the climate report, I'll turn to Mr. Gillespie to fill in the detail there, please.
Yeah, maybe we'd be better following up and writing, but the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan is currently being updated, and it's obviously central to what we're doing in that space, and it will link into the report that we're expecting. So both of those will come together, and I think they're both interlinked in that sense.
Mm-hmm. But we'll make sure and follow up in writing to the committee as and when that report from Mr. Withers comes back, and to give confidence to Mr. Beattie's question that the two elements will be joined up.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. There's just one other area I'd maybe like to explore a little bit, and that's about money. None of this is going to happen unless there's sufficient investment available. Now, obviously, government investment probably will be somewhat limited in comparison to what's been described as an eye-watering sum that's needed to succeed with a just transition. However, we've also been assured that there is plenty of private capital available. Now, the calculation was done not on a UK basis, but on a global basis. How do we know that there's going to be enough specific capital available to Scotland to cover these costs?
So that is a work in progress and part of the area that we touched upon in my session with the Net Zero Committee yesterday with Ms Hislop, was around how we ensure a successful supply chain, but also a successful infrastructure to ensure that we're able to deliver on our net zero ambitions. Mr Beattie is right that public finance is finite, and we have already touched upon the current challenges that there are in terms of public finance as a result of the areas of impact that there have been over recent years, thanks to decisions out with of our control. And we continue to work with the likes of the Scottish National Investment Bank, with our investor panel, to look at where we can leverage private capital to ensure that we're able to meet those demands, both in terms of investments in private, in terms of private capital coming in for the supply chain, but also in terms of the infrastructure that's going to be required. I mean, you know, the scale of it is indeed very challenging. The electricity service operator estimates that for the grid infrastructure alone requires a £7 billion investment. It's a substantial amount of capital that's going to be required. We will do what we can, both in terms of our investment priorities, to deliver as much as we can within that envelope, but we'll also be looking to work with private capital to ensure that we can meet those demands.
Now, private capital is only going to come in if they have reasonably managed risk and if they get a return on their money. Now, given the highly speculative nature of some of the initiatives that are underway, because we're still dealing with emerging technology, and how are we going to de-risk that? And de-risking obviously means that the risk moves someplace else, not that it's eliminated. So would that entail the Scottish Government taking on additional contingent liabilities?
Mr Beattie is right in his assessment around you know, where private capital will arrive at. We're working, as I say, with the likes of the Scottish National Investment Bank to look at ways of making Scotland as attractive as possible for inward investment. Scotland already is punching above its weight in terms of inward investment compared to the rest of the UK. So I think we're already giving some confidence to the market that we're a good place to invest. I've just returned from Japan, where a very significant decision was taken around inward investment to help support the supply chain for our offshore wind opportunities from Sumitomo Electric. They're looking to build a very substantial factory here in Scotland to produce the cable that's going to be required for the offshore wind industry. So Mr Beattie is right that we cannot be complacent, but I think we already see good confidence from the market as Scotland being a good place to make investment decisions.
Given that, that the assessment's already been made that globally there is adequate private capital available, which to me seems a bit odd because private capital is already much in demand for financing our existing technologies, our existing industries. And it seems strange that there's this massive surplus of capital waiting to come in. However, that was a global calculation. What is the calculation in Scotland and the UK as to the availability of the capital within our markets without having to rely on competing with other countries?
We are competing, is the honest answer. We are competing on an international scale, which is why our international network and the work that the likes of SDI and our office network internationally, the work that they do is so important. They build the relationships, such as with the likes of Sumitomo, to give confidence and to outline the opportunities that investing in Scotland gives them. We'll continue to work with the likes of Scottish Development International, with our international network, to ensure that the investment priorities that we have, which we've already outlined around our net zero commitments and the supply chain, are communicated to potential investors globally. Because you look at the investments that have been made in the United States and in Europe, the new Green Deal, you can see that we are competing in a highly competitive international market. We cannot afford to allow ourselves to be left behind when our net zero ambitions, some are very challenging, and the decisions on areas like offshore wind and hydrogen, the decisions that are taken over the next couple of years are going to be crucial in us continuing to be a world leader on offshore wind and continuing to be have the opportunity to be first to market in the likes of green hydrogen. So my encouragement obviously would be to the UK government to look to match some of those investment incentives that have been made by the European Union and the United States to ensure that we are not left behind on a competitive front compared to those nations and regions.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. We are taking evidence from Graham Stewart, the Minister for Energy Security and Net Zero from the UK Government, after yourself, so I'm sure some of these issues will come up again this morning.
Look forward to listening to that back.
Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Good morning. There's a slight feeling of plus ça change as I address four men in my favourite theme about how we alleviate some of the issues of women's representation in the economy, and I'm sure you'll not be surprised. Now, obviously, I've seen the sort of promotion of narrowing the gender pay gap you mentioned earlier, but it's so much more than that when we look at the systemic issues in our economy. I remarked in a debate last week that well-being particularly must have a gendered lens, utterly fundamentally. And being completely honest, I feel as though, if anything, we're moving backwards rather than forwards. And the reason I say that is that my colleague, Ms Hislop, who made sure that there was insertion of a women's business network and a spend of around 50 million, as I recall, to that. Obviously, that was incorporated into what we were looking at in terms of the Anna Stewart review. So my first question to you is, can you give me more flavour of what specifically you're looking at in the Anna Stewart review and when you're going to be able to come back with what recommendations you're able to support? That's my first question.
I thank Ms Thompson for her questions. I first of all say I absolutely take the charge around a Manal being before her. I was cognizant of that before we came today, made that very reference to colleagues before we came today. I have to say, yesterday in front of the Net Zero Committee, I was flanked by two incredibly able women. So we have incredibly strong women across the Scottish civil service, as well as very able men that are before you as well. Ms Thompson is absolutely right to focus in on the opportunities that there are from us, not just narrowing the gender pay gap, but the gender employment gap, and ensuring that women are able to get on in enterprise. It is a massive economic opportunity as well as being the right thing to do. And if we are to succeed in meeting economic growth opportunities, then having women get on in enterprise is going to be incredibly important for that aim. And I happen to be meeting with Anna Stewart later today, where I look forward to discussing her report and how we might be able to implement that. I'm committed to ensuring that we are honouring the report as best we possibly can in a timescale that resources would allow us to do so. But I think it is absolutely central to the opportunity that we have, both in transforming the economy to being an innovative, agile economy, but one that ensures that women are able to continue to perform well within it, which drives the economic growth that we're wanting to see.
If I could emphasise one area, which was actually in Anna Stewart's report and is encapsulated in Recommendation 30, is around the collection of data. As it stands at the moment, we don't have the data sets that enables us to gather what we need to measure it and to affect change. Arising from that, then, we further don't apply any conditionality to public sector funding, whether it's to women or indeed equalities generally, which I accept is a wider area. So are you Can you give an indication of how open-minded you are to at least taking the first step? And I would emphasise it's the first step, because if you can't, you can't measure it and improve it if you don't even collect it. And that is why, in my opinion, we're at a pretty low marker. Are you willing to commit today to look at that as a minimum, which incidentally is an undertaking I've had from the former Deputy First Minister, and that didn't come to pass either. So I'm really pushing you on that, if you could.
I think Ms Thompson absolutely gets to the nub of the issue. We need to understand the landscape within which we're operating in order to ensure that we're informing policy decisions to improve the situation. So, yes, to answer a question directly, I'm more than open-minded. I think it is the first step. Would be to ensure that we are working on that initial recommendation. I can't, you know, give a full commitment until I've met with Ms Stewart and until we publish our response in detail. But she has certainly got a sympathetic ear from me in that regard.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald, to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thanks very much, Convener. And morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wanted to ask you about Scotland's export performance. So, the Trading Nation, the strategy for growing exports from 20% of GDP to 25% of GDP was quite an ambitious target. You know, we're in year four of that strategy, and we've faced us being taken out of the EU against our wishes and faced a global pandemic. Are you able to update the committee on where we are in growing our export market?
Yeah, so we're currently sitting, colleagues will correct me if I'm wrong, at 21%. That is in spite of the challenges that have been faced with the challenges that Mr MacDonald outlines in terms of Brexit, in terms of a global pandemic and decisions taken by UK government out with our control that have obviously hampered performance. Our international network performs an incredible job, as I've already outlined, of supporting inward investment into Scotland, but also supporting exports as well. I'm able to see that, as Ms Hislop, one of my predecessors, will have been able to do on the international engagements that we have carried out. The SDI network in particular performs an incredible job embedding themselves in target markets, understanding those areas, building incredibly strong relationships with business, but also understanding the domestic business needs as well for exporting. And we continue to support I believe it's 1,200 target businesses in Scotland that have the highest propensity for export, to ensure that they are continued to be supported in that regard. And it's an incredibly important area that we'll continue to support.
You mentioned strong relationships with countries that we're aiming to grow our exports in. How important is a Global Scot network?
Very important. We've currently got over 1,000 Global Scots. Mr Robertson outlined earlier this year the importance of the Global Scot network in feeding that business, academic and other needs. I was able again in Japan to meet one of our newest recruits to the Global Scot Network, who operates across Japan and America and Europe. They give us incredibly strong contacts. They advocate for Scotland, and we need to utilise them more, not less.
So, just getting back to the situation with the EU, in the strategy, 9 of the top 15 markets identified were in the EU. And, you know, we've been taken out of the EU against our will, with 62% of the population voting to remain in the EU. What impact has that had on Scotland's exports? And is there a need for us to refocus on the other countries that were listed in the strategy? I'm thinking about America, Canada, Switzerland, Norway and China.
It has undoubtedly had an impact, both in terms of political relationships, but also trading relationships. We've seen the incredible uncertainty and difficulties from a trading perspective over recent years. Obviously, welcome the progress that's finally been made with regards to the Windsor framework for the trade elements. But that comes off the back of a number of years of incredible difficulty for our exporters into Europe. We, on a political level, continue to try to make sure that we have strong working relationships with our friends in Europe, we'll continue to do so because it is an incredibly important market for us, as Mr. MacDonald has outlined. But the other countries that he mentions are also important, and so that's why our SDI network performs such an important job, ensuring that the areas of trade that particular countries we have strength with, or particular products we have strength with, they are able to ensure that we deliver on our ambitions from a trading perspective. But I don't know if either Mr. Cook or Mr. Gillespie want to.
And one of the things I, excuse me, one of the things I would point to is the alignment between the domestic economic agenda and our international ambitions. So you see the same priorities within, for example, the work that's going on to develop Scotland's innovation strategy around life sciences, around tech, and the priorities of SDI, the support that government gives those exports. And you're absolutely right, Mr. MacDonald. We are looking and we are studying markets such as the USA and Canada for opportunities. It's not an either or, it is both. But we are trying to support Scottish industry in those new markets.
And supporting Scottish industry to look at the new markets and for innovation, etc. What's the role of the trade board that was set up? And I realise that the membership was updated in June of 22. What was the reason for that? And is there a new focus from the trade board?
Are you able to? We'll come back and write into Mr. MacDonald that point. That's an area that predates my involvement. I'll need to come back on that.
So my final point is I believe there's been a delay in publishing the most recent export stats, and I was just wondering if you could give us some background to that.
I'll come in on that. Yep. So the Export Statistics Scotland is our main publication. It gives the exports both from Scotland to the rest of the UK and the rest of the world and breaks it down by market and does imports. During COVID 2020, we paused the survey. For a number of reasons, we felt it wasn't appropriate to go out at that time. We've now done data collection for 2020 and 21, and that's been processed at the minute. And we'll publish that probably towards the end of the summer. I think as part, because of the delay, we've looked to review the methodology to see if we can improve the data, given we've obviously taken more time over it. So we will publish those updated statistics later in the year, and we'll go out shortly to survey for the 2022 data, because it's really important data, because it gives us the breakdown. So we'll update that, and any changes in methodology we will take back through the series so that we've got a consistent set. So there's been a delay, partly COVID induced, but now we've got an opportunity to make a better survey out of it.
Okay, thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. Before I bring in the next questioner, can I just check? So the 2032 target of increasing exports to 25% of GDP, that's still the target that the government is working towards?
Yes, and we're currently sitting at around 21% of GDP.
And the first question I asked around developing economy and tensions within it, is there, within trade policy, that's often the area that is focused on for how does that marry up with the idea of a wellbeing economy? And I think Gary Gillespie talked about a move towards more local supply, and Ms Hislop mentioned our supply chain inquiry, which pointed towards those kind of issues, particularly concerns around climate change and emissions in terms of transportation. Has that led to any reflections on what our trade policy target is, whether that is still relevant in terms of how we see the economy shaping in relation to wellbeing economy and climate change pressures?
Yeah, we continue to reflect on that, obviously, and ensure that the work that we're doing as a trading nation is done in an ethically and sustainable way. So we continue to take the areas that you have suggested there, convener, into regard and when we are doing our work to ensure that, where possible, we are doing our work in a sustainable way that ensures that we are seeing economic performance, but not too much to the detriment of our net zero ambitions as well.
And in terms of taking it into the guard, I think you mentioned, it was maybe Colin Cook mentioned, did you say there was reports into our exports figures? Have they been changed in any way to take a wellbeing economy approach into consideration, the way in which we view the exports or what we look for, where we look for growth sectors within exports?
Sorry, convener, I'm struggling with my voice here. I was referring to some studies that are being carried out specifically into markets in the USA and Canada, and those are in-depth studies about export potential, not about the way in which figures are reported.
And is the research being carried out by the Scottish Government? Is that independent research? And does that take into account the government's approach to a wellbeing economy to think about what areas it is we want to expand in terms of exports and imports? Or
I'd have to come back to the committee on the organisation that's carrying out the research on our behalf. But the wellbeing economy and the ambitions of the wellbeing economy are clearly articulated within NSET, so that is that remains our extant strategy, and everything that we do is linked to the achievement of NSET, so there will be a flow through.
Okay, thank you. And when it comes to one final question before I move to Colin Smith, when it comes to the report that we're now expecting in May, the annual report on NSET, is the focus on the evaluation on that, is that around what a wellbeing economy is? Are we delivering on a wellbeing? Can I have the Cabinet Secretary's microphone, please?
Yes, is the short answer. There's a wellbeing economy metric that flows through NSET and the pillars that form it. So there will be a wellbeing economy lens on the performance and delivery of NSET, yes.
It's an annual report. Obviously, the strategy was published March last year, and it's a first annual report that will chart progress over the year in terms of the actions being taken forward under NSET.
Okay, thank you. Colin Smith, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thanks, convener, and good morning to the panel. One of the priorities of NSET is obviously to capitalise on the opportunities of the transition to net zero. But would it be a fair assessment to say that where we've seen the growth of renewables significantly reduce carbon emissions, it's not delivered the economic benefits it could have for Scotland? We were promised 130,000 green jobs by 2020. The Fraser Valley Institute put the actual figure at 27,000. Recently, the trade unions highlighted the fact that we've only seen around 3,100 jobs created in offshore wind. So why have we failed to deliver the real potential in jobs from the growth in renewables?
So we have created a new offshore wind directorate in order to ensure that we are learning from the process that was underway in terms of onshore wind and the supply chain that fed it. And I think you will see the early stages of that coming to fruition in terms of some of the potential investment decisions that are coming through as a result, to ensure that there is a strong supply chain, domestic supply chain here in Scotland, the likes of the Sumitomo announcement, but also the potential investments in the likes of Ardersier and Kishorn and other ports, where I would hope that we are able to realise the economic benefits, the jobs benefits that the renewables revolution has the potential to produce.
But you say about learning the lessons, Cabinet Secretary, from onshore, when the trade unions recently highlighted analysis that showed that we're also failing to deliver when it comes to offshore wind as well, that they highlighted the latest Office for National Statistics low carbon and renewable energy estimates that showed that in 2014, for every £1 million of income made by offshore wind farms, it was translated to 7 jobs. This has plummeted to just 1 job per £1 million of turnover for offshore wind farm companies in 2021. So the big wind farm companies seem to be doing rather well out of it, but why is it not translating into jobs? Why are we appear to be going backwards?
And so that is exactly what we're looking to try to address in the work that we are doing and the work that our international network is doing to attract investment into Scotland and to procure a domestic supply chain that feeds our growth still to come in onshore wind, but also the massive growth that is still to come in offshore. I think Mr. Smith's points are well made. We continue to reflect on them and ensure that we are providing as much support as possible to ensuring that we have a strong domestic supply chain. That's, again, a point that I was making to the Net Zero Committee yesterday in response to a strong but fair challenge from Ms. Hislop, because I think it's important that where communities have are neighbouring to either onshore or offshore projects, that they're able to see discernible benefit. That obviously comes through community benefit, but also in terms of the economic performance that's derived from having a strong Scottish supply chain and domestic jobs that feed it. So we're absolutely committed to that, and we'll continue to do the work to ensure that we are honouring that. I don't know if Mr. Gillespie, you wanted to come in.
No, I mean, I suppose just on the figures you're quoting, obviously these sectors are really highly capital intensive. So once they're set up, onshore wind's the same, the actual multipliers and local benefit is much reduced. But what you do get is the capacity of bringing on renewables provides opportunities to the wider economy, and that's really about energy resilience, economic resilience. So it's quite similar in capital-intensive industries that a lot of the benefit comes in that early investment stage, and it's actually maintenance thereafter. But the benefit of having that energy, we're now seeing through the investments that are coming to Scotland to develop that into other forms of energy, whether it's hydrogen or other sources. So I think it's a two-way thing, really.
Those figures that are quoted on the trade unions, I mean, they showed that in the 7 years of 2021, turnover for these companies has gone from 95 million to 2.594 billion. And the number of jobs that's been created in Scotland is 3,100. I mean, that's a lot of money for the wind farm companies and not a lot of jobs. So what are we going to do differently when it comes to ScotWind to make sure that we actually get those jobs? And will the government have a target? Because we know that ScotWind will create jobs, of course it will, but will it create the potential that we believe that it can and should? I mean, will we have a very clear target for the number of renewable jobs that will come from ScotWind?
So I've already outlined the potential for green jobs that comes from having a good, just transition, and we'll continue to work with the supply chain development programme to ensure that we're maximising those opportunities of ensuring that there is a strong domestic supply chain feeding what is a growing and incredibly strong potential for our renewables programme. We are world leading, and you know, again, referring back to my engagements in Japan, the Japanese, others around the world are looking to what Scotland is doing as a first to market in terms of the offshore wind, green hydrogen, particularly floating offshore wind. But we cannot be complacent as being world leading. We need to make sure that we keep pedalling fast to ensure that those investment opportunities are there, and also ensure that there is discernible economic benefit domestically. That includes ensuring there is a strong domestic supply chain and ensures there is a strong jobs performance as well. That is the way that we ensure that there is a just transition. We have made a number of investments through the Just Transition Fund, including the Skills Passport, to ensure that we have jobs transferring from your traditional oil and gas sector into the renewable sector. And we'll continue to make those investments to ensure that communities are not left behind in the way that they were in the deindustrialisation under Thatcher in the 1980s and early 90s.
So what, you know, do you have a target? What would the proportion of those supply chain jobs be for Scotland from ScotWind?
The Chief Economist has already said why it would be difficult to make specific targets because the development of these projects is capital intensive. Sometimes it is depending on the project that we're talking about, you can see clear discernible benefits in terms of jobs. But I give Mr. Smith the undertaking. I'm determined, the government is determined, that the establishment of the new directorate within government gives credence to the fact that we are determined to ensure that we have a strong domestic supply chain that delivers good jobs in Scotland from the renewables revolution.
Okay. If I just may answer that. Because the Cabinet Secretary has spoken about the creation of ScotWind, which I think is a really important marker of our ambition. It's also worth pointing out that the enterprise agencies in Scotland, and particularly Scottish Enterprise, are really refocusing all their actions and all their, you know, they are prioritising this as the markets of the future. And I think that's really significant because it shows the whole of the economic development infrastructure of the Scottish public sector focus on the same targets. So I think you can have some comfort and assurance that we are focusing on this very, very strongly throughout that network.
And so it should, because it's the opportunity for growth, but it's just there is deep concern that we will not meet the potential, you know, and particularly if we don't even know what proportion of those supply chain jobs from Scotland will actually come to Scotland. And there's a concern over that, that we'll make the same mistakes we made in the past. In south of Scotland, all the wind turbines peppering the landscape in my region, none of them were built in Scotland. And we need to make sure that we don't make the same mistake with ScotWind. And it's slightly concerning, I have to say, that we're not able to set a target for the proportion of those supply chain jobs that will actually come to Scottish companies so we can measure that. But I don't know if I've got time to completely pivot to a completely different subject.
You can do it.
On a completely different subject, one of the issues that I are keen to hear from the government is on the role of cooperatives in the well-being economy. So that will mean you changing your pages quite significantly because it's a completely new subject. But what do you see as the role of cooperatives and how will the government support the growth of cooperatives in Scotland as a model?
So I should declare an interest at this stage as a member of a cooperative and highlight the fact that I'm incredibly supportive of the work that they do. And they are the embodiment of what the wellbeing economy is all about, where you have good, strong, ethical business practice that sees clear, discernible benefits to local communities. So we will continue to do what we can to provide support to the cooperative movement and ensure that they continue to flourish.
I should declare an interest as a cooperative MSP convener, but so what does that mean in practical terms? What proportion do you think cooperatives should make up of the Scottish economy as a result of that support the government are likely to give them?
Obviously, we want to see them continue to succeed. We don't have a particular target in terms of the question that Mr. Smith has outlined, but I'd be happy to provide more information to the committee on the work that we do to support the cooperative network off the back of this, and I think Mr. Cook wants to supplement my...
Yeah, I think I'd point to two actions. Firstly, the work that we've been doing on community wealth building and the consultation that's just closed around future legislation, which I think creates a framework in which to promote different forms of business models. And secondly, again, the NSET, to refer back to the strategy, talks about our economic ambitions as being to create a diverse economy. It talks about creating an entrepreneurial mindset in all sectors of the economy, and that would include alternative business models. So we are taking action, and we will use the economic development network I referred to earlier to focus in on promoting alternative business models within that.
Thank you. Maggie Chapman.
Thank you very much. And good morning to the Cabinet Secretary. Thank you for joining us this morning and for what you've already said. Like Colin Smith, I want to talk to focus my questions on two different areas across your portfolio. The first being Fair Work. And the Scottish Government has pledged to make Scotland a Fair Work nation by 2025. And I was just curious to know how you see this being measured, where you see the challenges are, and how progress is going, given that that is not 2 years away.
I was very pleased that one of the first meetings that I had upon taking office was with the Fair Work Convention, and the role that they play is incredibly important in, as a partner, but also a critical friend in holding us to account to ensure that we are doing all we can to honour our Fair Work commitments. We have refreshed our Fair Work Action Plan, published December last year, which sets out our approach to embedding fair work and tackling workplace inequalities.
Okay, thanks for that. I'm just wondering where you see some of the challenges, because it's all very well saying that we will be a Fair Work Nation by 2025. What's that actually going to look like, and what is it that are there any areas that you are concerned about in us being able to realise that ambition?
So it is a constant challenge. I've got a responsibility across government to ensure that I'm driving a Fair Work agenda. We're doing well already. We've got the highest level of employees paid the real living wage anywhere in the UK, the lowest number paid below the real living wage anywhere in the UK. We've also got incredibly strong labour market statistics that pose an opportunity, but also a challenge. A very tight labour market poses opportunities to discuss with employers the importance of advancing the Fair Work agenda to reduce workplace attrition and ensure continued support of employees. So we'll continue to progress that alongside the likes of the Fair Work Convention, the work that we do closely with the STUC. I'm due to meet Ross Foyer soon. Again, I believe I was on the table with her at the Anti-Poverty Summit that the First Minister hosted last week and had a very good conversation off the back of that. So we'll continue to do all we can to ensure fair work drives success, well-being, prosperity for individuals and businesses, and ensure that employers continue to understand the importance of demonstrating fair work, not just because it's the right thing to do from a social perspective, but actually because it derives good economic benefit to their organisation as well.
Thanks for that. I suppose one of the areas of interest within this that I have particularly is pushing conditionality as far as possible. Obviously, we know that employment law is reserved, so there are limits to that. But do you think that we are pushing the Fair Work conditionality in public sector grants as far as we could? Where do you see progress still to be made in that space?
So I appreciate Maggie Chapman's question here. Obviously, result of the Bute House agreement, we have conditionality being attached from, I believe, the 1st of July, where public sector procurement has Fair Work principles attached to it. I think that's an important first step. Obviously, we'll keep that conditionality under review in terms of its effectiveness, but also whether or not there are opportunities to go further. But I think we will need to ensure that there is time from the start of that process on the 1st of July to ensure that that is monitored, to ensure that it, as I say, is effective, and we can review whether or not there are opportunities to reform that in any way.
Okay, thanks. If I can shift to my second area of questioning, and that's around local and regional economic development. You spoke in your opening remarks about economic empowerment for local communities, creating better communities, and obviously key to this, and indeed I think the realising of a genuine wellbeing economy, are engaged and resilient local communities with decision-making powers and a real say in their local and regional economies. Can you identify what your priorities are for the regional economic partnerships, how you see those being developed over the coming months and years?
So we're looking to build upon the city and regional growth deals that have come through, and also respond to the review of regional economic policy to look at, obviously to work with regional economic partnerships to ensure that there are regional intelligence hubs, simplify the funding landscape. I'm due to meet with our enterprise agencies over the coming weeks where I'll be looking to discuss this and the suggestions that they have and how I respond to those over the coming weeks and months.
I suppose in some ways this links to or extends the questions Colin Smith was asking about how we ensure benefit for investments like ScotWind actually are retained in local communities, and we don't want to recreate two-speed economies like we've seen in previous times in different places. And I think something that's key to that is a clear placemaking agenda. And we've seen that in work that this committee has done in previous inquiries. But how do you see placemaking fitting into that regional economic development agenda? And where are the barriers to achieving that, do you think?
So place is incredibly important. You know, I represent a constituency with incredibly strong feeling of place, but also come from Orkney, where place-based economic development is clearly well-defined, and there is a very strong feeling of place. So I understand well the importance of place, and as I say, the discussions that we have with our enterprise network, ensuring that there is a good, strong support for economic development in their regions, but also ensuring that we're capitalising on the good work that is already going on indigenously in those areas, but also responding to the economic priorities that we've set out within NSET and with our Just Transition strategy to ensure that we're taking advantage of the opportunities that there are in different areas across Scotland. You know, I think it would be a challenge for us to say that there's going to be a homogenous approach to this across different areas, because each region, each local area, particular place is going to have a strength that others may not. So what we need to do is make sure that we're building on the strengths of each local area to ensure that we're seeing the best economic performance possible. Colin. Mr. Cook was wanting to come in.
If I may, Convener, I think hopefully you see the answer to that question in the two things we've referred to over the last few minutes. Firstly, the regional economic review, which we accepted, and as the Cabinet Secretary says, we're now prioritising work on the funding landscape and intelligence hubs. Our commitment to working with regional economic partnerships to ensure that the regional priorities are reflected, and the work that we do within community wealth building to encourage those regions to use that as the vehicle for ensuring that the benefits do remain, do bring benefits to local communities. So I think it's in the combination of the two, the regional economic policy focus and community wealth building, that you start to see the answer to the question that you posed, Ms. Chapman.
Thanks very much for that, Colin. And I suppose just finally then, one of the challenges with that is when you've got these, you've got city region deals, you've got community wealth building, you've got all of these trying to fit together. How is it that we do retain economic development coherence, but also within that, I suppose, policy coherence? Because it's perfectly possible to see a situation where we have alignment around a regional economic partnership that actually jeopardises some of the community wealth building agenda or priorities that parts within that community, within that region might have. And I just wondered how you are assessing that sort of overall coherence across all of these different economic development opportunities and agendas.
What I would say is I think we share we share your understanding that coherence is important. I mean, clearly, if you're pursuing a strategy that is based upon regional priorities and the interests of local communities, there will be diversity. That's implicit within that approach. What we try and do in government is to find ways of supporting the regional economic partnerships to be able to acquire the intelligence they need, realise their ambitions, promote the concept of community wealth building at a local level, and work with UK government to try and make sure that there's a coherence to the way in which Scottish government and UK government view the regions of Scotland and support work at that level. And I think that's a really important part of that overall coherence argument you've been making.
And are you confident that we've got the tools and the structures in place to do that?
I'm hopeful.
OK, thank you. Just before I bring in Jamie Halko-Johnson, referring back to Colin Smith's question around cooperatives, while there's no target for cooperatives, there is a target for 500 employee-owned businesses in Scotland by 2030. So the Cabinet Secretary might not know the progress update on that this morning, but it's going to be something he could write to the committee about.
I'm happy to do that.
Okay. I'll bring in Jamie Halko-Johnson to be followed by Fiona Hislop. I will let members know that we need to finish by 10:25.
Thanks very much, convener. Thanks, and good morning to the committee and to the Cabinet Secretary. I've got a couple of subjects I wanted to cover. The first one was really kind of follow-up to Graham Simpson's questions. You'll be aware of the issues around the relationship with the Scottish Government and the GFG Alliance and Sanjeev Gupta. I was just wondering whether you've met Sanjeev Gupta yet, or if you plan to.
I haven't met Mr. Gupta. I don't have current plans to do so.
Okay, thanks. So, can you kind of explain what the kind of level of engagement, regular engagement between the Scottish Government and GFG Alliance is?
It's regular, to quote Mr. Johnson's question back at him. It's regular and strong engagement with the smelter to ensure that the business there continues to do well, that the requirements on GFG are realised, and that the developments off the back of that are also realised. So there is regular and strong engagement. Mr. Cook leads on that area, and there is a very strong team that ensures that the investments in Lough Arbour continue to go well.
Okay. Thanks very much for that, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, you say investments go well, but a lot of jobs were promised when this deal was signed. Do you have any concerns that those projected jobs, job kind of suggestions aren't going to be met? I think it was into the hundreds, but maybe only 50 have been delivered so far.
There are ongoing investment decisions to be taken there that would see job creation. But I'll take Mr. Cook in at this stage so that he can provide more detail for you.
I mean, you're correct, Mr. Johnson, that the investment has not yet been made. The GFG Alliance are still planning on making an investment in a billet plant within that region. Money is being allocated to that investment. All the money has not been yet allocated to that investment, but we are making progress, and we have seen the start of the sort of planning phase for that investment. So we are hopeful that it will continue. It is one of the things we discuss regularly with both the local management, where I think our main focus has been around the plant, around the performance of the smelter, and around the performance of the hydro, but also when we get access both at ministerial and official level to GFG Alliance more generally.
I think it's important to stress as well that the guarantee is income generating for the Scottish Government, and the Alliance is up to date with its fee payments to date, and will continue to make sure that that is the case going forward on the investment decisions that Mr. Cook provided more detail on.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that. Can I ask then, in terms of the liability, because in 2019 it was some, I'm trying to remember the figure, about 570 million. Do you know what the current liability is Ah, well, see, that will decrease. So do you know what the current liability is?
It's decreased substantially. I'd be happy to give... I've got a rough figure in my head, but I don't want to give an incorrect figure to the committee. I'll make sure that that is followed up in writing for Mr Johnson's inquiry to be satisfied.
That would be great, and that would be very helpful. And I mean, you have no concerns at the moment that there's any likelihood that there will be payments to GFG, or you're anticipating having to make any payments to GFG at the moment?
There is nothing anticipated, no. The progress is good. As I say, it is currently an income-generating asset for the Scottish Government, but we'll obviously keep a close monitoring on the situation there to ensure that our investment continues to be strong and the commitments around the likes of the billet factory and others are met.
OK, thanks for that. If I could just move to another kind of vital kind of area. We know that there's huge pressure on our tourism and hospitality sectors. I'm sure, Cabinet Secretary, you will have had plenty of representations from the sector over the pressures that they're facing at the moment. You'll have seen some of the gaps in high streets. You've seen some of the real kind of issues faced. A number of businesses, certainly eligible businesses in England, are receiving 75% discount for this year. That money was available through Barnett Consequentials. Has there been any consideration or reconsideration about introducing a similar discount in Scotland?
So we have made significant investments to support business through and post-COVID, over £500 million beyond the support that we received from the UK government to do so. We've got the most competitive poundage in terms of non-domestic rates in the UK. We have also the most competitive small business bonus scheme in the UK. We continue to provide business support where we can. Obviously, Mr Johnson is right that I and my colleague Mr Lockhead engage regularly with the hospitality and tourism sector, and will continue to do so. It's a vital component of Scotland's economy, and we spoke earlier around regional economic performance and place-based policy making. So we understand the importance of tourism and hospitality, continue to engage them with them on the asks that come forward.
Thanks for that. I mean, a number of the asks will be around funding support, but I imagine a large part of that will also be around regulations. We've seen, obviously, a number of policies that impact within the sector or in communities that are in. We've seen DRS, it's been mentioned already today, and some of the uncertainty around that and the cost involved around that. The short-term licensing has been an area. There's other concerns around the tourism levy, and even as wide as HPMAs, you know, in rural communities like the ones that you and I are from, it's a real concern as a wider, you know, investment money coming in. So, you know, when you're looking at those asks for them, what consideration are you giving to some of the policies that the Scottish Government have been pursuing over the last few years, and whether some of those can be reconsidered, as has already been done in some cases?
So there is a panel that meets with business to consider regulation, and I've already set out the New Deal for Business that is being that is going to be discussed over the coming months. We are looking at all of those areas to see if there's anything more that we can do. We can consider how we can provide greater support. We've obviously listen to business in terms of the delay to DRS, and we will continue to respond as best we can. But one of the issues that Mr Johnson raises there around short-term lets, there is clearly a competing issue here, because he and I both know the challenges that there are in terms of access to rural housing for people living in rural areas, and there is I think is a support for us looking to do what we can to make more rural housing available. So the decisions that we're taking are about trying to make those situations easier for people. It's always going to be a balance. And obviously we take feedback from colleagues who represent rural areas, or indeed are from rural areas and have family still in rural areas, such as myself, to ensure that we continue to get that balance right. And obviously I take the feedback that Mr. Johnson has given seriously, and will continue to consider as best we can going forward.
Just very quickly on that point of rural housing, convener, if I could just ask this. I mean, the Scottish Government... Sorry, it's just a very quick question.
Sorry, if it's very... I do want to bring Ms Hislop in before the end, and we do have to move on as we have the UK Government Minister coming in.
I'm happy to take the question, and then even if it's responding in writing, convener, I'd be happy to do that.
If you would like to put the question, then we'll get a...
That's great. Thanks, convener. It was really just on that rural housing and islands housing question there. Obviously, the Scottish Government's scheme for that was extended and hasn't been fully utilised, only half of the rent. So it was really just an assurance that he will review that scheme and how it can be more attractive and more easy to use, because at the moment, clearly it isn't meeting the needs that it should be.
I'm happy to do so and ensure that I follow up in writing to the committee.
Thank you very much. Fiona Hislop.
Thank you.
I very much welcome bringing the economy and the energy portfolios together. The energy strategy consultation on the draft closed yesterday. When do you expect to respond to that and publish the actual energy strategy and the just transition plan?
I thank Ms Hislop for that question. We have received incredible interest from that consultation. I believe at last count there was over 1,400 responses to that, which is almost seven times the last time we consulted on an energy strategy, so there's clear interest in it. We need to make sure that we give that proper consideration, but we'll be looking to publish our final strategy as quickly as we can off the back of considering those consultation responses.
So the draft was very much welcomed by the renewables industry. It very much focused on electricity. Criticism was it was so broad, it was capturing everything that had been done to date. If previously the strategy had been about the generation of energy, surely we should be in a position that we should be looking about what that means going forward in terms of the delivery. It talks a lot about potential, but can you give us reassurance that the final strategy will be about delivery on that potential as opposed to description of the potential?
Yes, absolutely. Take that suggestion from Ms Hislop and make sure that's given due consideration as we consider the consultation responses, which I can't preempt, obviously, but I would expect to go into some of the areas that she's laid out there, but ensure that we have a concrete strategy that ensures that we are able to realise the potential that we have, but also ensure that we have a just transition that doesn't leave communities behind in the same way that they were in the 80s and 90s under Thatcher.
And what we've heard in our inquiry into just transition is there's a potential gap, particularly for the supply chain in terms of jobs and skills, where the actual realisation of the contracts may not be for some time. We might not be able to scale up in time. So therefore, the issue might be when the demand is there, it may have to be met internationally. So there's a gap funding issue in the skills and jobs and the supply chain. How do you think that can be realised?
So we're working on that now with the investments that we're making in the skills passport to ensure that we're looking to offer opportunities for those that are currently working in the oil and gas sector to transition. Obviously, that is going to be an ongoing process, but we will maintain a focus on ensuring that we're giving as many opportunities as possible to our Indigenous workforce, but also, you know, making sure that we put the pressure on the UK government to ensure that the international labour force that we have to accept will need to play a part in some areas is able to do so.
Skills passports won't necessarily address the technology issues for companies, so I would maybe leave that there, that needs to be looked at. And finally, we've heard about the need for billions of pounds of investment to realise net zero goals. Can you say how fundamental you think the carbon capture, utilisation, storage Acorn cluster is for the just transition, not just for the North East, but as we've heard from Grangemouth, with £1 billion from INEOS sitting on the table ready to move for the biggest industrial cluster and emissions that we have in Scotland What is your view on that?
It is absolutely fundamental. You know, Grangemouth produces 8% of our carbon emissions. It is our, as Ms Hislop rightly outlines, our greatest emitter. Making sure that there is a just transition ensures means that we need to see the UK government move much faster on seeing acorn delivered from Track 2. It is an absolute priority for us to continue pressing the UK government for that. And I'm sure that is something that will come up in the discussions with Mr Stewart following my appearance today.
Thank you, and we're in on time.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ms Hislop. I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary's officials for the evidence this morning. I'll now briefly move into suspension while we change over witnesses. So our third item of business this morning is an additional evidence session for the committee's inquiry into a just transition for the Grangemouth area. I'd like to welcome Graeme Stewart, who's the Minister for Energy Security and Net Zero from the UK Government. And he's joined by Catherine Asherwall, who is Head of Track 2 Team, CCUS, and Jonathan Hall, Deputy Director, Clean Growth Directorate. As always, if members and witnesses can keep their contributions as concise and focused as possible, that would be helpful. And I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Well, thank you very much, Convener, and to members of the committee for inviting me and indeed my officials to join you this morning to talk about our net zero ambitions and our Powering Up Great Britain announcements within the context of your inquiry into the decarbonisation and just transition of the Grangemouth area. The UK Government continues to engage positively with Scotland and the other devolved administrations across various policy priorities to support energy security and net zero. And I know you're fully aware of issues around carbon capture, usage and storage, hydrogen, nuclear, floating offshore wind, and of course the UK emissions trading scheme in which we are all equal partners. I'm grateful for the engagement and look forward to it continuing. For too long, this country has taken cheap, plentiful energy for granted, but Putin's illegal war in Ukraine and decades of over-reliance on fossil fuels from abroad, despite the UK having very little exposure to Russian gas, have combined to push up energy prices. That's why the UK government stepped in this winter to pay around half of the typical household energy bill, and why support has now been extended for domestic and business consumers alike. Our longer-term challenge and opportunity is to bolster our energy resilience as a nation so a tyrant like Putin can never again hit the pockets of every family and business in Britain. We think the path is clear. We must diversify our sources of supply, decarbonise and move towards greater energy independence so that we have cheap, clean energy that Britain needs to prosper in future. So that's why in March of this year, we published a suite of documents under the Powering Up Britain banner, including our net zero growth plan. We believe our transition to a green and sustainable future will provide new opportunities. As Chris Skidmore said, following his review, probably the greatest opportunity that Britain has at the moment to grow and level up the UK economy and support hundreds of thousands of green, high-skilled jobs, whilst ensuring the environment is also in a better state for the next generation. The policies and ambitions we set out will help leverage around £100 billion of private investment as we develop new industries and innovative low-carbon technologies, with ambitions to support up to around 500,000 jobs by 2030. The UK has already, of course, made tremendous progress in decarbonising its economy and decoupling emissions from economic growth. Between 1990 and 2021, we cut our emissions by 48%, while nonetheless growing the economy by 65%. We truly are the world leader among major economies, and the path to net zero outlined in the net zero strategy is, we believe, still the right one. And in the net zero growth plan, our update, we're bolstering our delivery further. The proposals and policies we've set out reach far into the future, setting out plans to the end of Carbon Budget 6 in 2037. And this means the current package represents one of a series of steps, full decarbonisation of the economy by 2050. And given our success in decarbonisation to date, we're confident in our approach, but this plan does not intend to predict the exact shape of the British economy in 2037 or later, and neither should it. In conclusion, Convener, the Prime Minister's decision to create the Department for Energy Security and Net Zero was a clear statement of intent that the UK government is prioritising these two important issues. And in our comprehensive Powering Up Britain announcements published just 50 days after the establishment of that new department, we demonstrated that we're driving real progress to deliver energy security, meet net zero, lower energy costs in the long term so that we have among the most competitive electricity prices in Europe by 2035 and secure economic benefits that will be felt throughout the whole of the UK. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. For this inquiry, the committee is particularly focusing on the Grangemouth area. As you will know, INEOS is based in Grangemouth. It is described as the biggest polluter in Scotland. Its emissions are larger than any other site and company that we have based in Scotland. If the UK government is serious about cutting emissions, it will recognise the importance of taking action at INEOS and in the Grangemouth area. So can I, as you know, the Scottish Government are working on a draft just transition plan for the Grangemouth area. Can I ask what discussions you are having with the Scottish Government around the plan and what in particular from the measures you've outlined are relevant to the Grangemouth area that you think will assist in delivery of a just transition for Grangemouth?
Well, thank you for your question. I mean, there are a number of components, aren't there, in the sort of net zero journey. Decarbonisation of the electricity supply by 2035 is an ambition, but we've got land use and agri issues to deal with to minimise and move to net zero there. We've got transport to deal with. We also have, and this is most particularly relevant to Grangemouth, we have to decarbonise industry. And that's why, as set out in the Powering Up Britain documents, we are moving forward with intent on two technologies which are absolutely fundamental to delivering that decarbonisation of industry, and they're particularly the hard to decarbonise. So in addition to sort of increased electrification and the greening of our electricity supply is carbon capture, usage and storage. And that's why we have moved forward with Track 1, the East Coast Cluster and the HyNet project in the northwest of England, but we highlighted that we were launching Track 2, and we said that the Acorn project and the Scottish cluster and indeed the Viking store again off Lincolnshire were in pole position because they are the most advanced, but we opened that up out so that we could have expressions of interest in being included in Track 2. And we also said we would look for extensions of Track 1. So we think if we're going to decarbonise industry and industrial areas, whether it's in the Humber, the northwest of England, Scotland or Wales, we're going to need carbon capture, usage and storage. And then I would also add hydrogen is the other technology initially, perhaps blue hydrogen. We've set out ambitions for 10 gigawatts of hydrogen by 2030, which at least half should be green hydrogen, that's electrolytic hydrogen. And we made announcements on that front as well, with various awards in Scotland. I think it's a really exciting opportunity for Scotland as we roll these technologies out, because if, as we hope, we can lead the world, as we have in cutting emissions, we can then lead the world in developing genuine net zero industrial clusters, then not only is that big business in its own right, but it will unlock, I think, the reindustrialization and massive inward investment into those areas, given the ESG and other environmental obligations which companies have entered into. And I really do see the UK has an opportunity in Scotland in particular, and perhaps in the Grangemouth area in particular, has a huge opportunity to unlock development, not just in energy, but actually more broadly, if we get it right.
OK, thank you. Colin Smith to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. You touched on the issue of carbon capture, and the committee has heard how vital the Scottish Cluster carbon capture project is to supporting the transition of Scotland's industries, especially around the central belt of Scotland. Now, you said that the Acorn project is one of two in pole position in the Track 2 process, but we've had few details of what that actually means at a time INEOS have said they're committed to investing £1 billion to decarbonise Grangemouth and support the cluster. So, Minister, can you tell us more about the Track 2 process Will the planned update in the summer settle once and for all whether the UK government is committed to ensuring that the ACON project is taken forward?
Well, we are grateful to the Scottish Cluster for its continued engagement. And as I just said, and you reflected in your remarks, we've recognised the maturity of the proposals, Mr. Smythe, and we've stated our view that based on engagement to date and the Track 1 process, ACORN meets the Track 2 eligibility criteria and doesn't need to submit an expression of interest. My colleague, Lord Callanan, who is the Minister responsible for CCUS, has previously engaged with the ACORN cluster, including speaking at the recent ACORN reception in Parliament. And at the working level, there's been a regular dialogue with the Scottish Government, and we're always happy to facilitate further engagement if thought fruitful. We're working to deliver the Track 2 process as quickly as possible, ensuring that we learn the lessons of Track 1, whilst also ensuring competitive tension and value for money. But there are, as you'll be aware, Mr. Smythe, risks associated with all infrastructure projects, and the Scottish Cluster is still working through questions, allowing all eligible transport and storage systems an opportunity to express an interest in the Track 2 process is in line with our objectives of ensuring that Track 2 optimises delivery and represents value for money. So there's a lot of work going on beneath the surface. And I'm pleased to say, I think the government has invested around $40 million into ACORN to date. But as you'll be aware, if we're going to meet our legal obligations to deliver net zero, we need to move at pace and we need to decarbonise not just major clusters, such as the Scottish Cluster, but actually industry right across the country. But we need to move at pace. We're seeking to do so. And I think there is a very positive future for ACORN in CCUS.
I agree, Minister. We need to move at pace, but the ACORN project has been under development for more than a decade. I'm sure you appreciate there's considerable frustration from potential developers. So could you tell us why there has been what appears to be such a lack of progress in supporting that process, that project? And back to my first question, will we get a clear announcement in the summer whether or not the UK government supports taking forward the ACORN project?
Well, as I say, we are moving as quick. Due diligence on that, and that's why I'm not trying to be deliberately evasive, but I'm trying to avoid giving you a definite date if we may not be able to deliver it. But that work is underway, we're moving at speed, and I hope it will be sooner rather than later. I'm afraid that's the best I think I can give you today. Unless officials scribble me something else, but I don't think they're going to, because we're moving at speed, and if I give you a date, we miss it, and that's unhelpful all around.
I'll give the officials more time to scribble if you wish, Minister. But do you accept, do you accept, Minister, though, that without the ACORN project, we won't decarbonise Grangemouth and we won't have a just transition in that area?
Well, as I've said, we need to decarbonise all of our industries across the UK. So we're seeking to move in a methodical manner. And as you'll be aware, around the world, other people are looking at this, and it's a tough challenge to get it right. But I think we are blessed with industrial geographies coupled with the geology that makes it possible for us to lead the world in developing these technologies. If we can't decarbonise Grangemouth, we're not going to be able to deliver our net zero targets, which are set in law in both Scotland and the United Kingdom.
But do you accept we can't decarbonise Grangemouth in the scale that's required without the ACORN project?
I don't know any alternative ideas to do that, so we have to have a project to do that, and ACORN, as the government has set out, is in pole position, has met the Track 2 criteria, and further announcements will be made in due course. I don't think I can give you any more than that. We have to do it. ACORN's in pole position. It's met the criteria. It's looking pretty good, isn't it?
I hope so, Minister. Thank you.
Gordon MacDonald might try to get more than that, but I'll take Gordon, then followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thanks very much. Just to continue this theme from Colin Smith, I'm aware that on the 27th of April, Andrew Bowie, Parliamentary Under-Secretary of State for Energy Security and Net Zero, told our NZ committee that he would be overwhelmingly delighted should ACON be successful through the Track 2 process. He also said that it is vital to Scotland's 2045 net zero ambition that we get more carbon capture and storage on stream across the whole of United Kingdom. Do you agree?
Yes.
So if you agree, why is it that we're still seeing delays to funding of the project? And, you know, it's inexplicable to many observers that ACORN was excluded from Track 1 status. And I know you've responded to questions on this from Colin Smith, but are you able to add more detail about why it's considered secondary to those clusters selected by the UK government to receive Track 1 status?
Well, ACORN has met the eligibility criteria for the Track 1 process and performed to a good standard against the evaluation criteria. But during the competitive and rigorous application and evaluation process, the HyNet and East Coast clusters were selected as the Track 1 clusters. The sequencing decision was made following a robust specialist-led assessment and was not subject to political intervention at any stage. Ensuring that the result reflected this assessment was crucial in upholding key principles of transparency and value for money. So we have as dispassionate a framework as we possibly can to make sure that we do this in the right way, and we can, as we deliver this and get it out there, we will cover the whole country in due course, but we're moving in a methodical manner, doing this in a scale in a way that has never been done in the world before. And that's why we're doing it in this fashion. And that's why I think it is the right way that we do it on this layered manner, with competition on a fair basis, mutually determined outcomes in place. And that's why ACORN, which did very well, was made the reserve, of course, but didn't make it on competitive and dispassionate grounds into Track 1.
So you just mentioned a couple of times the East Coast cluster, and that was announced for Track 1 funding from November 2021. But in recent weeks, we've had the National Grid withdrawing. We've had Shell withdrawing as well, who indicated that they would focus on the ACORN project in Scotland. And Drax has recently paused its investment into the project as well. What does that do about the viability of the East Coast project? And does that give you an opportunity to review funding and bring ACORN further closer to getting UK government funding?
Well, our CCUS targets remain on track, as does the delivery of the East Coast cluster, with the world-leading capabilities of BP, Equinor and Total Energies driving the project through the Northern Endurance Partnership. As Shell has made clear, it is committed to the technology with a focus on other projects in the UK. And government will continue to work with the industry on our ambition for 4 industrial clusters, CCS clusters, by 2030. As I've said, ACORN remains the reserve cluster for Track 1. Naming a reserve cluster allows the government to retain the option of elevating the Scottish cluster into Track 1 in place of either HyNet or the East Coast cluster in the event of material barriers to delivery arising.
When would that elevation of the ACORN project, when would that first opportunity come around for review to take place and possible elevation?
In the event of material barriers to delivery arising, Mr. MacDonald.
So, given that you've had 3 major players either withdraw from the East Coast project or pause investment, does that not cause you to review the East Coast project?
We are confident that the East Coast cluster is progressing right now, and if that were to change in light of the circumstances that you refer to or others, we would be in a position to review it. But at the moment, we're confident that it is on track.
Thank you so much. Fiona Hislop, followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, and I very much appreciate you joining us today, Minister. The issue around the Acorn cluster is critical, yes, to Grangeworth, which is the subject of our inquiry, but also to a just transition in the north of Scotland. You refer to maturity and infrastructure as being key in terms of decision making. This is the most mature and the most developed, and using existing infrastructure in terms of a project. And you make the argument yourself that we can't decarbonise Grangemouth without having the Acorn project. And if we don't decarbonise Grangemouth, we won't meet our net zero targets. And also the third leg of that is the Climate Change Committee has said that the UK and Scotland won't meet our net zero targets unless we have CCUS. So this all leads to one place. The issue then is the timescale for this. And clearly you said by 2030, for Scotland to meet our targets, we need to start sooner than that. So will you be cognisant of the timing of this in talking to your colleague, Lord Callaghan, on any final decision?
I didn't quite understand the question at the end there. Apologies.
So the issues around net zero targets for the UK, you talked about 2030. For Scotland to meet its targets, we will need to start on our carbon capture, utilisation and storage journey sooner than that. And therefore, if the imperative and the logic of your own arguments is such that the Acorn project is well placed, will he, in his discussions with Lord Callaghan, who I understand you said is the lead minister in this, emphasise the timescale of this is critical to Scotland, probably more so than the rest of the UK, although it is critical to the UK?
Well, I mean, the Scottish Government makes its own determinations of targets, and I know the Committee on Climate Change has remarked on the pathway that Scotland is on towards those, and has remarked specifically on the 2030 target and how realistic that is. But I'll leave that to them and the Scottish Government to worry about. We are delivering the UK Government's policies in order to deliver net zero by 2050. Given that we set the national framework, it would be sensible for areas of the country, including the devolved government in Scotland, to ensure that their policies were compatible with ours, perhaps rather than the other way around.
But also in terms of your responsibilities as UK, you're responsible for all of the United Kingdom. And clearly on energy policy, the UK government has the key powers in relation to carbon capture, utilisation and storage. Is that the case?
Indeed, and we've set out a strategy to have four clusters by 2030. Whether that fits with the Scottish government's targets or not is a matter for the Scottish government to deal with. We are quite clear on doing it, and we do it while listening closely to the Independent Committee on Climate Change and making sure that we deliver what is. We're leading the world in this, and there's a danger of coming up with impractical targets which can't be met. What we've got to do is work in a coherent manner, which we do everything possible to do, and engage with Scottish and other devolved governments to make sure that we are working in an aligned manner. But there's a tremendous opportunity here to not only to protect the jobs we've got, but actually create the foundation for a much more successful Grangemouth area in the future if we get it right. But we're going to continue to implement our policies as set out in successive policy statements from the UK government.
Thank you. I would refer the Minister to a report produced by the Scottish Parliament's Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee last year on carbon capture, utilisation and storage. It had cross-party, all-party support, and perhaps set out the case in a stronger place than we perhaps have time to do today. Can I move on now to the wider hydrogen economy? Clearly, Scotland and the UK have significant ambitions. What we have heard is that in order to advance on the broader hydrogen economy will need further work on developing credible business cases to help draw in that private investment that you talked about, and to bring the various technologies that were required to market. So what is your view of what can be done, and what is the UK doing to support the technology on hydrogen to reach maturity and to attract that significant investment that's needed? It's an element of risk, Minister, so I suppose it's what is the UK prepared to do to help move that market on?
Well, we've just published a list of successful applicants for strands 1 and 2 of the Net Zero Hydrogen Fund, and that will support the development and deployment of new low-carbon hydrogen production, exactly as you suggest. This announcement confirms the first project to be offered grant funding through the NZHF for a total of £37.9 million for 15 new hydrogen production projects across England, Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. And I think from memory, I think 4 of those are in Scotland. We intend to launch a second competition round for strands 1 and 2 of the NZHF in spring, which will be delivered by UKRI. And the second competition round will support the development of a diverse and secure hydrogen economy fit for meeting the UK's ambition, which I will be mentioned, of up to 10 gigawatts of low carbon hydrogen production by 2030. Just worth saying that in addition to that, 5 Scottish companies have been shortlisted to proceed to the next stage of the process for the first electrolytic hydrogen allocation round, HAR1. I always say my department's particularly bad at naming things, but anyway, there we are, to kickstart the low-carbon hydrogen economy across the UK and meet our wider net zero targets. And those are ERM Dolphin, with a Y, Pale Blue Dot Energy, SSE Renewables, RES and Octopus Green Hydrogen, and Scottish Power. So that's in addition to the NZHF, Net Zero Hydrogen Fund, we've also got this hydrogen electrolytic hydrogen allocation round, and Scotland is playing a full part in both parts of that. And if I pick one random, Octopus Energy's Lanarkshire Green Hydrogen Project plans to deploy 15 megawatts of electrolysis directly connected to an onshore wind farm with the aim of producing over 3.5 tonnes per day of green hydrogen. And when I was at the European Marine Energy Centre in Orkney not long ago, I was delighted to see there that they were one of the first producers of green hydrogen up there, and I think it powered the first sustainable aviation fuel RAF flight, they were telling me when I was there. So, you know.
So we sorry, is it frozen again?
Minister, at the moment the... Oh, sorry, you had frozen for a second.
I think you're back. And finally for me, the opportunity for green hydrogen is considerable, not least because of the extensive renewable energy that can be released from ScotWind, etc. And you talked about energy security, which is not just for the UK, but obviously more widely in Europe. We've been told by industry that export of green hydrogen has real opportunity. How seriously is the UK government taking the opportunity for exporting of green hydrogen to meet the demands of our colleagues in Europe?
Well, great question. And the UK's primary ambition is for 10 gigawatts of low-carbon hydrogen production capacity by 2030, so as to decarbonise UK sectors and contribute to our legally binding carbon budget. So that's the kind of top of our hierarchy. This increased ambition, as set out in the British Energy Security Strategy, does, though, also open up the opportunity for exports. I would say if you look at a map of Europe, and you look around the British Isles, I mean, we have a remarkable and special opportunity capturing all that wind power. And of course, we're not only world leaders in fixed bed offshore wind, but developing floating offshore wind, which is enormous global potential as well. If we capture all that, and we can do it in a way which is economically sensible as well, then not only can we deliver among the lowest cost electricity systems in Europe by 2035, which is our aim. But as you rightly highlight, harnessing all that, if we can then take an example of what's gone on in Orkney and elsewhere, we can convert it into highly competitive green hydrogen. Will not only decarbonise our own industry and act as a that will, I think, trigger additional investment into the UK, including Scotland, but it also puts in place the potential that we could be, I don't know about you, I could imagine a future in which we might have pipelines going into Europe. We have interconnectors now of gas and electric, makes us both sides more resilient as a result of that. We could potentially in future have CO2 pipelines bringing in CO2 one way for us to store. After all, we've got 78 gigatons of capacity of carbon storage in the North Sea. It's given us wealth when we emptied a lot of those wells of oil and gas. It would be fantastic to get further value by then storing carbon as a result. And we could have hydrogen flowing in the other direction. So I share your enthusiasm. If we get this right, we can create the foundation of economic prosperity in the 2030s and beyond, so that we can both lead the world in tackling the environmental challenge, but if we get it right, we could also come out as more economically competitive and a richer nation with better jobs and greater energy security as well. That's the kind of the golden prize we're after. And of course, Scotland has an outsized role to play in delivering that. And we want to make sure it's done in a way, and hydrogen, again, offers a way of not just producing energy in Scotland, but converting it in Scotland, having industrial jobs in Scotland, and making sure that Scotland benefits from its quite unique position and ability to generate energy and contribute not only to UK energy security, but Europe's.
Thank you very much for setting out Scotland's strength in our energy now and in the future. And with that, Convener, I'll pass back to you.
Thank you. Graham Simpson to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I'm going to ask you about sustainable aviation fuel now. We've dealt with hydrogen, so we'll move on to SAF. Now, you, the UK government, produced a Jet Zero strategy in July last year. And you said that by 2025, so that's just 3 years away, you would have at least 5 UK SAF plants under construction and a SAF mandate in place with a target of at least 10% SAF by 2030. So, of course, the relevance of this for us is that we would want Grangemouth to be one of those plants. So can you tell me what you're doing to ensure that you get those 5 plants in place?
Well, thank you, Mr. Simpson, for your question. As you say, in July last year, we made a commitment in the Jet Zero strategy to make the UK a world leader in the development, production and use of sustainable aviation fuel. And since then, we've made excellent progress. We've announced recently a series of big steps forward. So we've published our second SAF mandate consultation, providing a strong incentive to use SAF and offering price support for it. We've launched the second application window of the Advanced Fuels Fund, making a further £56 million available to support UK SAF projects through to construction. And to accelerate novel SAF production pathways to market, we're also setting up a UK clearinghouse to support testing and certification. And we announced the University of Sheffield as the delivery partner for that. In parallel to those steps, the government has been considering what longer-term actions, in addition to the SAF mandate and the grant funding for SAF plants, might need to be taken to stimulate SAF investment in the UK. So in October of last year, we commissioned Philip New to lead an independent evaluation into developing our UK SAF industry so that he could identify the conditions necessary to create a successful UK SAF industry and recommendations to support it. We published his report alongside our government response, and it sets out how we're already taking actions to address many of his recommendations. Amongst those are, for instance, working with industry on stabilising the UK feedstock market for low carbon fuels. Our response recognises that revenue certainty remains a barrier to investment and commits to working with industry on options to overcome that particular barrier so that and those become investable. While noting the leading role industry can play, we have committed to work on options to provide additional revenue certainty in order to deliver that investment that's needed. If required, following that work, we will launch a formal consultation this summer.
Yeah. So you're going to. So there'll be a consultation this summer, but you want to be in a position in 3 years' time that you have five SAF plants under construction. It sounds like we're nowhere near that at the moment. Is that correct?
Well, the UK's SAF programme is one of the most comprehensive in the world, with, as you say, a highly ambitious mandate for 2025 that provides a long-term signal that now is the time to invest. We've made that £165 million available from the Advanced Fuels Fund, in order to help deliver those five plants, to have them under construction in the UK by 2025. We're helping to establish a UK clearinghouse, which will support the testing and certification of innovative fuels. And together with the SAF mandate, which of course drives an awful lot of this, we have measures which both support the supply and create the demand for SAF. So we're confident that this framework of measures puts the UK in a leading position to reduce aviation emissions and start a UK SAF industry. We recognise there are calls to go even further to build a long-term supply industry in the UK, but we're working in partnership with industry and investors to determine what further actions industry or government might be able to take.
Yeah, OK, thanks. I mean, you basically just repeated your first answer, but the question was, you have set the target of having these five plants under construction within 3 years. And from what I'm hearing, yes, you're doing some stuff, but we're not at the point in that tight timescale of getting any of those plants under construction. Is my analysis correct?
There aren't any in construction, as far as I'm aware, right now. As you rightly say, Mr. Simpson, it's a challenging calendar to get that done, but we are working flat out to make it happen. And of course, carbon capture has a part to play in SAF production, and getting that in place, there are a lot of moving parts in order to make sure that that can be delivered, and we're interested in doing so. Perhaps,
obviously, sustainable aviation fuel is a Department of Transport's lead, and we can certainly get some more detail on the level of progress against that five, but the £165 million Advanced Fuels Fund that the Minister has already mentioned, that is the key thing that is supporting plants going through up to development. It is a market, where can government stimulate, where can government provide grant support, and where can government provide the market certainty that enables investors to make the decisions do those things. It's not H&G SAF plans that we're putting in place. I think there's quite a lot of support that's going into SAF, and a lot of progress that's been made this year on it.
Yeah, it's market certainty that we need. Well, one final question, Minister. You've spoken about you see the importance of Grangemouth, as we do. Have you visited Grangemouth yet? And if not, do you plan to?
I haven't visited yet, but I do plan to, yes. I haven't got it in my diary as yet, but Grangemouth's clearly a very important plant. I have specific responsibility, not only for renewables, but for oil and gas. And Grangemouth is very important going forward.
Thank you. Maggie Chapman to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thanks very much, and thank you to the Minister for being with us and for what you've said so far. We've already had some discussion about the different timescales and the pace of change that is required, and it's quite clear that the transition is taking place globally at quite a fast pace. There's competition for skills, for labour, and for finance and investment. And we also know that the United States and the European Union have announced significant investments in renewable energy, and you've outlined already that this is a key sector for Scotland and indeed the wider UK economy. How can we ensure that projects and companies in Scotland and workers in Scotland benefit from the investment that should be available? How can we ensure that we are best able to compete and have access to equivalent financial incentives, particularly for renewables?
Thank you. Well, of course, we've made tremendous progress. As I've already said, we've decarbonised more than any other major economy in the world. I think we can, you know, the cross-party consensus on the need for action and the ability to convert that into action has been, a significant feature of Conservative-led government since 2010. You'll be aware, just 7% of our electricity in 2010, 7% came from renewables, and now it's over 40% and heading up towards 50 and beyond. And, you know, we have set up through the Contracts for Difference, which is now being widely copied, but it's an extremely successful system. It's helped bring scale to things like offshore wind, which the viability of the economics of which was not obvious when we went out into the North Sea, and yet we went from whatever it was, £120 a megawatt hour in the first auction, as a sort of guaranteed, you know, revenue requirement to build in 2015, to just £39.50 in 2019, two auctions later. So I think we shouldn't be complacent because of prior success, and we're looking at issues like non-financial criteria, and I'm working closely with industry on that, how we create the incentives in a way which meets our international obligations, but to strengthen the UK supply chain. We've built an enormous amount of business and prosperity in the UK supporting our renewables development, but I would like us to have done better. And going forward, not only for offshore, fixed bed and floating offshore wind, but CCUS hydrogen, I really want to make sure that we, as you suggest, really sweat how we create the frameworks which make it more likely that there will be sustainable long-term jobs in Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom built around our world leadership there. You mentioned the competitive environment. On the one hand, when we have commented that the Inflation Reduction Act in the US with sort of Buy American facets is unwelcome in that particular way. But to have the United States investing heavily in renewables and green technologies is tremendous. And I think it'll help drive down cost. And I am actually confident, notwithstanding, they should. On issues like CCUS, hydrogen and renewables, offers an opportunity for us to be able to deliver the kind of low-cost system we want. But I wouldn't, we've got greater competition because the rest of the world is playing, catch-up with us as we've led the world in cutting emissions. But I think that our frameworks in renewables and indeed carbon capture and hydrogen are pretty strong. We're still seen as world leaders. And we, of course, have moved now to annual auctions for the first time this year from biannual ones previously for the Contracts for Difference. And we'll see how that goes. It's always commercially sensitive until we close all these things out. But we've been tremendously successful in the past in getting investment, and I'm pretty confident that we'll continue to be successful going forward. And you've got new technologies as well, which such as tidal, where we're the world leader. AR4, which was our CFD round last year, had the first time we had tidal included in that, and we retained a specific pot for that this year. And I know, having visited when I was in Orkney, I saw O2's Orbital's O2 tidal energy production unit, and around 80% of the supply of that's coming from the UK. I'm determined to do everything I can, including through the development of non-financial criteria in partnership with industry to increase and strengthen the UK supply chain, and that will have a big impact in Scotland.
Okay, thanks for that. I appreciate what you said about us having achieved significant changes in recent years, but I suppose, you know, we know from the IPCC report that actually the pace of change that we need to achieve in the coming 15, 20 years is even greater than the pace of change that we've seen to date, given the climate emergency that we are facing. And I suppose one of my questions around the investment that you say you are certain we can continue to attract, is it your intention, or is it the UK government's intention to ensure that investment has conditions attached to it in how it's delivered in Scotland? Because we've heard from people within and around Grangemouth that maybe the transition, previous energy transitions have not been as just as they might be, and there's been widening inequalities as a consequence of that. We see that elsewhere in Scotland as well. How is it that you intend to ensure that the investments we do get drive a just transition and don't create or enable the development of two or multiple speed economies such that we've seen in the northeast of Scotland?
Now, Minister, before I invite you to respond, I understand you have to leave by 11:30. I do have two members who wish to ask questions. I'm going to allow Michelle Thompson to ask her question on the back of Maggie Chapman's, as I believe they're connected, and if you address both their questions, and then I'm hoping to bring Jamie Hulko-Johnson in before you have to leave. So, Michelle.
Good morning. I think they're somewhat loosely connected, but I know I hope you'll be able to pick up Ms Chapman's question. I wanted to just probe a wee bit about the capital requirements. We know that globally it's hundreds of trillions of dollars required in terms of investment to meet what we need to do. I suppose my question to you, my colleague Gordon MacDonald touched earlier on the withdrawal of National Grid and Shell from the East Coast cluster. That will have been noted by international investors, and a view reached whether that was about competence or other reasons, but that will have influenced some of their appetite for investment. In general terms, what specific risks do you have in your risk register for attracting international investors into funding? What are the sort of risks that you've got and that you're therefore seeking to mitigate to get to the scale we need?
Well, thank you. So dealing with both those questions, on the just transition front, I mean, when I was before I went to Orkney, I went to Port Nigg, and I also went to Aberdeen. And actually, what I saw there was that there is, in a sense, the support businesses were all practically all the ones I talked to were working in both oil and gas and renewables, because the subsea skills, the fabrication, the engineering, the rest of it are all allied. And you know, I think it's so important that we recognise that we are in a transition. I do find it unhelpful. The Scottish Government appears to be so opposed to managing what is a naturally declining basin in the North Sea. And what we will have is, over time, we expect the amount of business that some of the businesses, including the ones I met, have from renewables will grow, and the oil and gas business will reduce. But it's so important that we don't seek to just, you know, abandon North Sea oil and gas. We won't have that just transition. And worse than that, we'll end up, for instance, importing LNG, additional LNG, which has 2.5 times the emissions, the production emissions of Scottish produced gas, which is why with our, the gas production and oil and gas production falling at about 9% a year. With new licenses, we can arrest that perhaps to 7%, but it's falling faster than our demand reductions. But we've got to recognise that oil, gas and renewables now are one supply chain in Scotland. And if you want to have a just transition, and you don't play to the gallery, you recognise that producing power in Britain for Britain, oil and gas in the transition while we ramp up renewables, is one way of delivering that. On Ms. Thompson's question around capital requirements and what's on my risk register, it's stability, certainty, and continuity, as well as being open to innovation, I think are the key things that I would say are qualities we should have. And of course, the Climate Act from 2008, which we amended in 2019 from 80% to net zero, that gives that legal certainty. My Secretary of State is legally obliged to ensure that we're on track to deliver net zero. We're in not quite a unique situation, but we were the first major economy to legislate in that way. The Independent Climate Change Committee, the five-year carbon budgets. This creates a certainty that we are legally obliged to go in that direction, and the cross-party consensus that supports that helps give confidence to investors, as well as making the fact that we've always been. I used to be the investment minister. I would say possibly the most investable country in the world because of our stability, because of the rule of law, because people know it doesn't matter where they're from, they'll be treated fairly by our system. So that combination of solid regulatory and legal systems coupled with legal statutory certainty about the direction of travel is how we've been able to attract so much investment so far, and why I'm confident. I don't think I ever said certain, but confident that we will be able to continue to do so in future.
Well, thank you very much for that. And you certainly set out what you see as some opportunities. But my specific question was about risks. Can you give me more flavour, given the significant international competition for funding that is required? Can you set out more detail as to what you see the risks that external investors see in investing in UK at the scale they require, and what mitigations you're putting in place? Thank you.
Well, thank you. I mean, well, one of the risks would be refusal to grant any new licences in the North Sea for oil and gas.
We're talking about investing in renewables on this specifically.
Exactly. And I've said that oil, gas and renewables are now, in terms of supply chain, tend to completely overlap. And in order to deliver the transformation at Grangemouth, to deliver CCUS, to deliver hydrogen, what do you need? You need the engineering, you need the balance sheet, you need the supply chain of existing oil and gas companies. And one of the big risks to the transition is the removal of support for ongoing development and production of oil and gas in the North Sea. It might sound ironic, but you asked me what's on my risk register, that's right up there. Otherwise, it's in terms of the on the risks, I mean, there's competition, clearly, but I think we welcome that. My experience previously as the investment minister and now as the energy security and net zero minister is that there's an enormous appetite to invest in the UK. So it's building, one of the big challenges for my department, and we work with the Scottish Government and others, is to build the regulatory and legal certainties to allow investment. Things like, no one has done what we're doing. No one had done what we did in offshore wind, and we found a solution. And I pay tribute to the brilliant officials in my department who helped deliver that. Going forward, the sort of transport and storage regulations, standards around hydrogen and green hydrogen and carbon capture. It's so important to get those in place. So that's another risk that we, I was challenged earlier on the speed with which we can get SAF up and running and whether we can get those three plants going by 2025. We are running at 100 miles an hour and trying to be more coherent and joined up than ever before. Another key issue, obviously, is the grid and connections. All this generation is great, but if you can't get the electrons where the demand is, you've got a problem. I think that's why we now have a minister for nuclear and networks in the form of Andrew Bowie, because we have someone who is absolutely focused on working with the grid, with regulators and others. We have a complex set of regulations. We have to be able to deliver the programmes and projects to a timely manner, and if we don't, we won't be able to meet our targets and we will put off investment.
And you're absolutely...
Sorry, Ms Thompson, we are running out of time, and Jamie Harcourt-Johnson... Yeah.
If I could just finish one last question. You very clearly make the point, because if you ask what is an international company's risk registers in terms of investing in the UK, it's going straight after the project, i.e. the ACORN, carbon capture and storage, that represents the most commoditizable investment for them. So I'm rather surprised that that's not on your risk register. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Thank you. I will now allow Jamie Harcourt-Johnson to ask a question before we finish up this morning. Jamie,
thanks very much. Thanks very much. Good morning, Minister and colleagues. Just a very quick question. You've talked about Orkney. I'm dialing in from Orkney today, Minister. And I just wanted to get an idea of how the UK government is supporting developments within kind of more remote and island communities and that area. And you talked about networks, how that investment is happening.
Well, good question. I don't claim to be an expert, having visited Orkney, but it's fascinating to see what's going on up there, to see the potential for that, you know, an offshore wind, continuing oil and gas to ever higher environmental standards. The North Sea Transition Deal, of course, commits the industry voluntarily in a world-leading way to reduce emissions from production by 50%. By 2030. For that, we need to facilitate, and they need to facilitate, and we're trying to encourage and incentivise investment to electrify, for instance. So there's that sort of piece. Then you've got the tidal. And I heard plans while I was there for major port investment, looking at harnessing the huge energy production up in the islands, which is, by definition, an awfully long way from the core English demand centres, but we've got to get our locational pricing signals right. Some of the biggest potentials in Scotland, but if we don't reflect the economic cost and indeed some of the political challenges of delivering the network reinforcements, we're going to get ourselves in a problem. So we're wrestling with that as part of our big electricity markets arrangements review. But when I was there and hearing about the opportunity to work on the ports there and develop greater hydrogen, green hydrogen production in the islands, for instance, I mean, on the one hand, if we have a properly cost-reflective system around the cost of reinforcement for connection, and if that, in some ways, it creates the incentive to do more with the energy in the islands, for instance.
I think every time I go to explain what's happened, it starts again. So there you go. Minister, before you leave, I realise that I did cut Michelle Thompson off on her question. If you could maybe return to that. And Maggie Chapman, I think if there's time, her question was cut short as well. I think Maggie would like to briefly come in before we close. But Michelle, do you know if you want to repeat the final question or the gist of it would be helpful?
I suspect the Minister has got my gist regarding ACORN. I think that's a point I've probably well made. Just quickly, if you could cover off the challenge. Post COP26, there was a great deal of optimism investors, but what the ABI, in giving evidence to this inquiry, noted was that there was still a shortage of packages that their investors are able to crowd funding into. And of course that talks to risk and appetite and packages and so on. Are you able to give a little more flavour about that? Because there's clearly huge appetite, but we need the things that people can invest in. So can you give any more thinking, because we're not getting to the scale we need at the moment?
Well, in March and April, we published updated net zero investment roadmaps for hydrogen, CCUS, as well as two new roadmaps for offshore wind and heat pumps. And so that's addressing the point you're raising and trying to make it as easy as possible for people to understand the landscape and the opportunities. They articulate investment needs and opportunities alongside relevant government policy and the funding of support and funding support available to investors. And we plan to publish further roadmaps later this year to support the net zero transition, and we will refresh them as necessary when there are significant developments.
Okay. And I'm sorry, Maggie.
Very briefly, if I may, Minister, I was asking about how you intend to ensure that any investment we get is conditional on it being key to delivering a just transition, so we don't get a two-speed economy being set up as we have seen in previous situations, such as the northeast of Scotland. That just transition for communities is really, really important.
I'm not entirely clear what you're getting at, because I mean, a market economy is a market economy. If we can bring investment in and people are competing for workers, and we have colleges and training people up for those jobs, and then hopefully we will have good and sustainable long-term jobs. I'm not sure there's some magical government framework which can, the risk would be it would stand in the way of investment, overcomplicated.
I would ask how you ensure that people and communities don't get left behind, as some people and communities have been left behind in previous energy transitions.
Okay, forgive me for my, I'm not picking up really on the reference. The most important thing we can do is get the investment, lead the world on the environmental challenge, and make it an economic opportunity. If we do that, there will be more and more jobs and opportunity. And if we work closely together, as we are doing, and it's great to appear before you today, and with the Scottish Government, and then with educational institutions, we can ensure we have people with the skills ready for when the demand for those skills arrives, and make sure that people get good, high-paid, long-term, sustainable jobs. I entirely agree with you. We don't need to have this revolution going on in which lots of people feel marginalised and sidelined. We've got to make sure that there's really something in it for local people when they have the major infrastructure put in place. A lot of that is about, I co-chair the Green Jobs Delivery Group, trying to make sure that we've got the right apprenticeship frameworks, we've got other programmes in place, so that when these jobs appear, they don't just all go to people who come in from outside. There's an opportunity for good jobs, not just the low-paying jobs for local people. But that takes a certain amount of coordination. I'm trying to make sure we're getting signals from the market, and that we're asking business to give us the data, so I can then work, I know in England, with the Department for Education, to make sure that there, whether it's T-levels, apprenticeship frameworks, the short courses that they do, that we have the right educational and skills development in place, precisely to avoid people being sitting there watching outsiders coming in and taking the job which they could have had if only they'd known about it and had been able to train for it.
OK, thank you. Thank you to the Minister and officials for their contribution this morning and the contribution to the inquiry we're carrying out into the Grangemouth area. I will now briefly suspend the meeting for our next agenda item.
Thank you.
We now move to agenda item 4, which is consideration of an SSI. The committee is invited to note the Public Procurement Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2023. The purpose of this instrument is to amend the Scottish public procurement regime to implement the procurement chapters of the free trade agreements between the UK and Australia and the UK and New Zealand. We did previously consider LCMs on this agreement. I invite members to note the instrument. That concludes the public part of this morning's meeting. We now move into private session.